Hello, my name is Diana Gracefield Toussaint, and I am an associate professor at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. And today, I'm really thrilled to be able to talk to you about obesity epidemiology, an area of my research. So what do I hope you'll get out of this lecture at the end? So hopefully you can answer the question, well, what is epidemiology? And then more importantly, how do we apply the principles of epidemiology to the study of obesity? So what is epidemiology? So it's the study of the distribution and determinants of disease frequency and health-related events in populations. That's the first part of the definition. And then the second part is how do we apply that study to control health problems? So let's break down this definition a little bit further. So first we talked about disease distribution. So what we want to know is what do we understand about the patterns of disease by person, place, and time? Who are the people that are getting the disease? Do we tend to find this particular condition in elderly people or maybe in younger individuals? Do we tend to find a particular condition in an area that is more urban or more rural, for example? And what patterns do we see over time? Do we find that the disease is increasing over time, or is it decreasing over time? And what might be those factors? So in the speaking of factors, we also talk about disease determinants when it comes to epidemiology. What are the factors that might bring about a change in a person's health? So when we think about obesity, for example, this might be that if you were to exercise, individuals who exercise more might be less likely, for example, to be overweight or obese because they're burning more calories. Or individuals that have diets that are more energy dense are more likely to be overweight, and we find those individuals then would be at higher risk for obesity. So what are these factors that play some role with respect to why people might have obesity? Disease frequency. So as an epidemiologist, we also want to quantify, well, how much of the disease is occurring in a population. So sometimes you hear some estimates of, well, we have the prevalence of a particular disease or obesity in the U.S. is X number. So that simply means what's the number of existing cases for a particular disease? And that really helps us to really determine whether we have a public health problem and how do we allocate resources. And populations. So one of the interesting things with epidemiology is that we're focused primarily on populations. We're looking, for example, at obesity in children, very concerned about studying that population. What's going on? What are the factors that might increase the risk of obesity among children? So usually when we think about populations, we're looking at a larger scale. We're looking at what kinds of policies can we develop to really make an impact on a larger group of individuals, a larger group of people. We aren't only looking at one individual. And then we want to know, well, if we have a sense of the patterns of the disease, we have a sense of, for example, what factors are contributing to that disease, then we want to know ultimately, well, we want to make sure that we're tracking that over time, and this is where surveillance comes into play. So you'll hear me talk about, I'll show you some statistics soon that are generated from the Centers for Disease Control, our primary public health organization in the U.S., where they take surveys of the population over time because they want to get a sense of what's going on. If we do know, for example, that if people can be more physically active, are we finding that over time, if the levels of physical activity are increasing, are we finding that that is having an impact on obesity by decreasing the number of individuals that have the condition? And then we use this, and this is where now epidemiologic research comes in. We hypothesize, for example, that if people were to exercise more, they would be less likely to be overweight or obese. So when we think about obesity, we think of it as having a high amount of body fat in relation to body mass. And this is typically based on what we call the body mass index. For children, this is based on the child's age as well as, so basically you're comparing them, are they overweight based on the age? And we look to see if they fall within a certain percentile. So if they're overweight, that you were usually looking at kids that are greater than the 95th percentile, and then at risk for overweight would be in the greater than the 85th percentile. So that's for children. For adults, when we look at BMI, individuals that we're concerned about are people who have a BMI either 25 or above, and then we're also very concerned about people who would be very obese, either obese or severely obese, and that can be either a BMI greater than 30, for example. So how do we know? So now that we have a definition in terms of how we think about obesity, how we assess it in populations, well, how do we know that this is something we should be concerned about? So one way we do that, we collect data and statistics. And one survey that's used quite a bit is the National Health and Nutrition Examination Survey that's conducted by the CDC. And this survey has been collected over time since the 1960s. And when we look at that data over time, we find that after taking all these cross sections of populations, we see that over time, the individuals with obesity are on the rise, especially when we look at men and women between 1960 to 2000. We're seeing a continuous increase in the number of individuals who are considered overweight or obese. When we look at children, very concerning, we see the same pattern. We look at kids, so for the purposes of this discussion, we're looking at children between, we're defining children between the ages of 2 and 19, between 1963 and 2008. So we have several years of data where we can look at the trend, and we see that over time, they increase in every age group, whether you're in the 2 to 5 year old, the youngest age group, through to the 12 to 19 year olds. So we're seeing that there's this pattern, obesity is increasing over time, we have a standardized measure where we're collecting data, and we're seeing that over time, there's this increase. Also, we want to see one of the things that we're concerned about. Again, we talked about patterns. We talked about distribution. So we also look across the entire United States. And these are some statistics from 2013, where we see, for example, the part of the southern United States, for example, we see higher rates of obesity. And now finding that most across the U.S., we really aren't finding any states that have obesity rates that are, say, under 20%. And this is a concern. What is even more concerning is that when we look again at these, you know, what's going on in terms of patterns, so geographically, we see what's going on across the U.S., but then we can drill down even further. What's going on with particular specific racial ethnic groups? And what's concerning is that when we look at the current statistics from the CDC at non-Hispanic blacks, for example, we see overwhelmingly that greater than 35% across almost all the states of blacks are considered, based on their self-reported height and weight, which we use to measure BMI, that they are also obese. So this is very concerning when we think about what groups should we be targeting, what groups should we be focusing on. We see similar characteristics when we look at Hispanic adults as well. What's even more concerning is that when we look at children, we look at data for children, we see some of the same characteristics. So here we have some information on another survey that's been done with children, where we find that Hispanic children, for example, 16% between the youngest kids, between the ages of 2 to 5, considered obese, and we see the same thing. And again, concerns for black children, where again, much higher rates when we compare them to, say, white children or Asian kids. So again, this gives us a sense of what are the patterns within the populations, which populations should we be focusing on? So why should we be concerned, for example? So now that we see the patterns and we, you know, we think about the determinants, we want to think about, well, what kind of research should we be doing? Where should we be focused? And so one thing that I'm particularly concerned about, one of the main reasons that I am focused on childhood obesity, is that there has been some research to show that if you are overweight or obese as a child, your chances of being overweight or obese as an adult increases significantly. So as an example, if you're overweight or obese as a preschooler, your chances of being overweight or obese as an adult is 35%. This is very concerning. And this is why, for example, we find it really important to start working with children earlier so that we can develop habits that they can then carry on through adolescence and adulthood that will then reduce their risk for overweight or obesity. One of the other things that is important from a public health perspective, epidemiology is considered the science of public health. So we're also concerned about, well, what are the costs of obesity? You know, why? So again, thinking about the factors, we know that we've seen obesity increasing over time. We see higher rates of obesity among racial ethnic groups within the U.S. And then we're also concerned, well, what does it mean if we have large groups of people who have obesity, what does that mean for the healthcare system? So here are some estimates that were done. And these, again, I mean, unfortunately, were done in 2009. showing that in 1998, in terms of total costs for obesity, we're looking at $78.5 billion per year in the US. By 2008, 10 years later, that number had jumped, has skyrocketed to $147 billion. So again, and what's really concerning is that Medicare and Medicaid, Medicare where we support our elderly, Medicaid that's primarily used for low-income individuals, that Medicare and Medicaid alone accounted for 42% of these costs. So again, showing that individuals that are vulnerable, individuals who are lower income, elderly individuals, they are going to be the ones that will need more care from us with respect to dealing with the consequences of obesity. So what can we do? So now that we you know, as a researcher, you know, well, here's this problem, what do we do? How do we use these principles of epidemiology to address and to study obesity? So going back to the definition, so what we've done, primarily we've looked at the distribution within the US, seeing high rates in the southern United States. We've also found that, you know, seen that in terms of the disease frequency over time, that is increasing, and that the population, some of the populations that we're really concerned about are racial, ethnic minority groups. So how then do we use some of this information to apply what we've learned about, you know, about what we've learned about obesity? How do we use that information now to control health problems, to control obesity? So let's think back, think to some of the principal targets that have come about for obesity prevention and control. And this is largely based on some work that has been done by the Institute of Medicine. So some of the things that critical targets, one, during pregnancy, encouraging women to have a healthy pregnancy weight, be very careful in terms of weight gain, getting lots of sleep. And I know that can be difficult as a college student, of course. You have a lot of projects to do, you know, and you're trying to balance so many things. But sleep is really critical in terms of, one, not only reducing your risk for obesity, but also doing well as a student. Reducing energy intake, increasing things like physical activity. So these are just some, and then some other ones you can read, but of course these are some of the important targets in terms of reducing obesity risk. Then we think about, well, how do we address this? Where do we focus our efforts? And so there's certain conceptual models that can be used to study diseases. So one is the socio-ecological model that has been shown where you sort of look at the individual and you're looking at what are some of the interpersonal, institutional, and larger factors that work on that individual in terms of influencing their risk factors when their behaviors or their risk factors when it comes to particular conditions. And what we found is that actually you have the greatest impact when you work sort of above the individual, when you look at those larger factors that might potentially influence obesity risk. So, for example, having policies to encourage neighborhoods that make it easier for people to walk, for example, has been shown to be important in terms of reducing obesity risk. But really finding that if we work, we have broader policies that can encourage and make it easier for people to engage in behaviors that can reduce their obesity risk, that we actually have more impact instead of simply focusing on an individual. So what are some settings for obesity treatment and for prevention and treatment? So early care and education, for example, working in the child care, working in child care facilities, ensuring that child care facilities have good policies with respect to healthy eating, working through school lunch programs, for example, workplace programs that encourage healthy eating, exercising, what have you. And some of the work that I have done, for example, has looked at the importance of green space, access to green space, and how that potentially influences physical activity. So for example, we found that kids who had more access to physical activity were more likely to be engaged, more access to green space, were more likely to engage in physical activity, they were more likely to be physically active. This is just one example in terms of policy recommendation, that if we can increase access to green space, for example, we can increase levels of physical activity and hopefully long-term reduce the risk of becoming obese as an adult for children. These are just some examples as well in terms of where to focus our efforts with respect to benefits, looking at cost-effect benefits of specific interventions. So for example, finding that if we were to focus on television advertising, reduce that, that would cost us 8 cents for per unit decrease in BMI. So doing things like even having a soda a tax on sugar sweetened beverages. So these are just some examples in terms of where we can implement policies and the environmental policies, and sort of giving us a sense of the bang for our buck. How much would it cost us? How cost effective are these policies? So moving forward, I think the critical thing that I would like for you to take from this is that epidemiology has complementary contributions when it comes to epidemiology. So we calculate disease trends in populations. It's important for us to understand what's going on with the trends in the disease. We want to make sure we collect good data. But then it's also important for us to think about, well, how do we communicate this to the public, to policymakers? How do we implement policies to make sure that what we have learned from the data, we can make sure that we make an impact on whatever condition it is that we're studying? And in this instance, with respect to obesity, we want to make sure that we have policies that can certainly impact larger communities that are cost effective, and where we can get community buy-in. So I really hope that at a minimum you can answer the question, what is epidemiology? And I truly hope that you have an appreciation for using the principles of epidemiology to study obesity. So good luck.